requirements of red are for the celebration of Reformation. This is the 504th anniversary of October 31st, when Martin Luther posted the 95 theses on the church door in Wittenberg, Germany, unleashing a Reformation within the Christian church. We're gathered for a service of Holy Communion this morning. We're following Divine Service setting number 3. It's also our day to collect the LWML mic boxes. If you have remembered yours, there's an opportunity to bring it up during the service. And if you have forgotten, just please bring it in at your convenience and bring it to the church office where it will get counted. There is a coffee hour that has been started, and it's pre-service. So if you're interested in fellowship that begins at 10 a.m., please come. It's currently being held in the meeting room, and we would like to gather as many people together for fellowship as we can at 10 a.m. on Sunday mornings. Lori and I are going to be away Monday, Tuesday, and returning Wednesday. We're going to be at a pastor's conference, and because of that, there will be no Bible study on Monday evening. So the Monday evening Bible study will be canceled for this week. The Lockport Cares annual fundraising banquet is on the calendar for November the 18th. That's a Thursday evening. And in the past, Trinity has sent a small delegation, probably 6 to 10 people each year have gone to the Lockport Cares banquet. We still would like to do that. There's a sign-up sheet on the table in the narthex. Please sign up. Trinity has enough funds to be able to pay for 6 people to go to the dinner, but of course you can buy your own ticket as well. And it is this year being held at the Wurlitzer building in Northtown, Florida. Flowers, this did not get printed in the bulletin, but the flowers behind me are in memory of Harold Williams. They were placed there by Jan Schneider. Harold was Jan's father. In our prayers this morning, we have a prayer for Len Fitchley, who is going to be undergoing surgery. We have prayers for Julius Brown, who is Tyler Struckmann's husband, who had surgery and is now recovering. We're praying for Jane Christensen, our secretary. She's been out of work now for 2 weeks, and we pray that she will be able to return soon. And we have a prayer of celebration and thanksgiving for the birth of Henry John McIndoo. Henry is the newborn son of Alexis and John McIndoo, and he is the great-grandson of A.J. and Grace McGraw. So we celebrate with them. Let us now stand as we begin our worship, singing hymn 657, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God.
Thank you.
us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
I said I would confess my transgressions unto you, O Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of my sin.
O Almighty God, merciful Father,
I, a poor miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you for your boundless mercy, and for the sake of your holy, innocent, bitter suffering and death, of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being.
Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I will speak of your testimonies before kings, O Lord, and shall not be put to shame.
I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth.
My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad.
Come, O children, listen to me. I will teach you for the fear of the Lord.
I will speak of your testimonies before kings, O Lord, shall not be put to shame.
Oh,
Protect and deliver us in times of temptation. Defend us against all enemies, and grant to your church your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
You may remain seated as we sing responsibly with the Cantor, the psalm that is most associated with the Reformation, Psalm 46.
Truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free.
They answered him, "We are offspring of Abraham and have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free?" Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The Son remains forever. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.
gospel, Jesus speaking to Hebrews who had believed in him. Every year on this last Sunday of October, in every Lutheran church that I've ever attended, we make remembrance and we celebrate the beginning of the Christian Reformation. And oftentimes we do that by recounting the events that began with the posting of Martin Luther's 95 theses on the church door in the city of Wittenberg, Germany, on this day in 1517. And Luther's writings and his determination, his refusal to recant of his teachings, his steadfast faith in the Word of God, all made for a profile in courage. And we even label ourselves as Protestants because of the protests that followed the emperor's decree that we should apologize to the Pope and ask the bishops for forgiveness. But all of those things, as fascinating as they may be, are really a side story to the message of the Reformation, which was not about people from the 1500s. Rather, it is an ongoing spiritual reformation, and it's all about returning the church to the message of the gospel and returning the Word of God into the hands of the people. And so sometimes we do it by highlighting the principles of the Reformation, those three Latin words, sola, that guided the reformers. In Latin, they are sola fides, which means faith alone, sola gratia, which is grace alone, and sola scriptura, which is scripture alone. And those three principles lead to the conclusion that it can only be sola Christi, Christ alone, who wins for us and grants to us salvation. Which means there are no extra hoops to jump through. There are no extra obligations that we need perform. And also it means the church is not a hierarchy of people and of power. Rather, the church as we understand it is the gathering of faithful believers in Christ to celebrate and to confess and to proclaim the good news of Jesus to the world. But where do we exactly find those ideals in the Bible? Where is it that God says that it's all about Jesus and not about the institutions that we build and their instructions that we follow? Well, how about our epistle reading this morning? We're in St. Paul's letter to the church in Rome. He explains, the righteousness of God has been manifested through faith in Jesus Christ. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and are justified by His grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by His blood, to be received by faith. For we hold that one is justified by faith apart from works of the law. And how about also in St. Paul's letter to the Ephesians, where the Holy Spirit inspires Paul to write, for by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. Jesus assures us in the gospel reading for today that those who abide in His word are truly His disciples. They will know the truth, and the truth will set them free. That is the eternal gospel. Freedom in Christ, delivered through His word alone, because we know that Jesus is the truth. And that's what we celebrate today and on every Reformation Sunday. Because all of us have sinned and all of us have gone astray, we've lost our freedom. We can no longer be righteous and true. It's just not humanly possible. We're all slaves to our sinful natures. The things we wish we had done, the things we still want to do, always fall aside to the things that we keep on doing, even when we said we would never do them again. Our sins just hold us fast, and we're all bound up in our guilt over those sins. And we all justly deserve the full consequences of every single one of our sins. And what does God think about all of that? Well, if a person were to bring something that belongs to you, say in a car accident, you then have a choice to make. Do you make that person pay for the damage, or do you just cover the cost yourself? Or if a friend or an acquaintance chooses to betray you, you could drop that person who has hurt you right out of your life. Or you can bear the pain, and you can look for a way to mend the relationship that's been broken. When sin entered the world, and people embraced it, God had a similar decision to make. Would he send his righteous wrath upon those people who broke his world? Would he avenge himself on the people who turned their backs on him to follow their own selfish ways? Would he allow them to be enslaved to sin and ruled by its full consequence of death forever? God's answer, pure grace, was no. He would not avenge himself on his children. He would not let them live in utter fear of him. He resolved to set them free from slavery and to pay their debt himself. And so he sent his son Jesus into the world, and as Jesus says, if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. As sinners, we only deserve to be held completely accountable for our slavery. But the Son of God takes the wages of our sin. He dies on the cross to pay our debt. He takes upon himself the torment of hell, hanging there abandoned by the Father, not for his own sin, but for the sins of the world. God absorbs the cost for what we have broken by giving his own Son into death that we might be set free. Slaves to sin like us have not earned any permanent place in God's family, but the Son belongs to this family forever. And so if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. That is the eternal gospel that Luther was empowered to bring back to the front and center of the church's preaching and teaching. But this is not just a piece of doctrine to be studied and taught. The Son really does set you free by making you a child of his heavenly Father. He makes sure that you have a permanent place in the family with all the rights and all the privileges that come along with being a son or daughter of his Father. And so you now have the full, free forgiveness of all of your sins. You have the assurance that death will not hold you captive. You have the assurance of eternal life with our Lord in his new heaven and his new earth. That's what Jesus means when he says, if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. The freedom Christ won for us is a freedom that he shares with us through the power of his word. And of that word, Luther taught that God's word is performative, which means not only does God tell us about things, God's word actually makes things happen. And so when God said, let there be light, there was light. When Jesus said to people, rise, take up your bed and go, those formerly lame people rose up, took their beds, and they went. When God says to us in Christ, you are forgiven. You truly are forgiven. When God says baptism, you are now my child forever. You really are God's child. When the pastor places that tiny bit of bread into your hand and bids you to drink of the cup of the Lord, and he says, this is the true body and true blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. That's God's word. That's no symbolic gift. That's no souvenir of the Last Supper. It's Christ's real body and real blood. And with that, Christ himself is speaking to you and setting you free. The scriptures you hear in the service, the sermons preached from the pulpit, the Bible verses that you read at home bring you his living, active word. It is sharper than any double-edged sword. And so as you continue to abide in the word of Jesus, that word continues to set you free again and again. No matter how many times we come back to our Father in repentance, he's always right there in his word to receive us back into his family, to strengthen us in our relationship to him, and to keep us as his own dear children. That is the very truth that sets us free. The angel that's flying overhead in our opening reading from Revelation bids us to fear God and give him glory. That's exactly the way that we should be responding on Reformation Sunday and every day. We approach God with both reverent fear, but also with confidence. We are in awe of his willingness to pay the cost for our sin and not cast us out of his family. We give him glory, for the Son has set us free from our slavery. And as we continue to abide in that eternal gospel, we hear and we know again, this is the truth, and the truth will always set us free. By the grace of Jesus. Amen. Please stand as we sing the offering. Give us good and faithful rulers who will govern after your good pleasure. we would not be deceived to think earthly powers will last forever, but have confidence in you alone. Your kingdom come, Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Hear our prayers for the sick, for the joyful, and for those in any need. We pray especially for the joy of new life given to Alexis and John McAdoo and the newly born Henry John. We pray for the needs of Aisha Kreutz and Julius Brown. We pray for Len Fitchley as he prepares for surgery. We pray for John Mish and A.J. McGraw, for Peter Sirocco, Chris Zanow, for Charlie Branch, and for Jane Christens. Answer their prayers, preserve them by your promises, and bring them safely through this world to everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have brought us by your word out of the darkness of error and into the light of your grace. Mercifully help us to walk in that light. Guard us from error and false doctrine. And grant that we do not become ungrateful and despise your word, but receive it with all our heart, conduct our lives according to it, and put our trust in your grace. In the merits of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
sing the note to this. Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you
Thank you.